Yes.
You may want to just introduce this and then futz around.
Okay.
Folks.
Thank you. Well, it can be edited. It can be edited. Not that that's not a ratings machine magnet. All right, we're on. So, welcome everybody. This is the meeting of the Stow Municipal Affordable Housing Trust. It's April 5th. We've taken care of some our usual business, and the remainder of the meeting will be talking about the proposal for a development of some affordable housing units on the Pine Point parcel, which we call, which is on the corner of Sudbury Road and Pine Point Road, down near the lake. What we thought we'd do first is kind of go over, you all have a timeline in, we've handed out, if those of you don't have it, there's more copies around somewhere. Go through the timeline of what has happened in the past and what will happen in the future, or the steps that need to occur in the future for this to continue. Well, the other little bit is to make some clarifications about things, is that one is that our intention all along has been, since this is really the first housing project that the town has really initiated, that, or certainly the SMAHT has initiated, but is actually coming from an entity of the town, as opposed to the other ones that have been done by, you know, Stow Community Housing Corporation, which is a nonprofit located in town. Although I think one of those projects, I think the first Pilot Grove was initiated before that was started, but eventually was put together by ACHC. Besides just this project that we want to put together, which we want to make sure this is a project that the whole town will be proud of, we also want to make sure that the process that we go about this is an open process, and we're modeling about how we want this kind of process to work in the future in terms of how we get community input and how we go forward with this type of thing. We've been charged by the selectmen and by town meeting many times about creating more affordable housing, more opportunities. We've done a couple of surveys, one in 2011 and another one in 2016, going out to the town, and there's a very large preference in the town for infill development. In other words, smaller affordable housing developments scattered around the town, not large ones. We have a couple of largest groups, but there's a strong preference has been in these surveys for that the town members would like these things spread around town, and that's good, and that's we want to act on that. The problem is that when you put affordable in town, it's in town, and that means it's next to other people who are in town, and that has effect on people, everybody. So there's a small benefit for everybody in town for more affordable housing to be built, but we want to recognize that wherever that housing is built, it's going to have a larger impact on people nearby or people going across. We want to know that we completely recognize that. We want to make sure that those any concerns that come up are addressed and taken into consideration for the proposals and the plans that go forward. So that's where we're coming from. This is, you know, as opposed to some developments where it's, you know, developers swooping into town and saying, you know, trying to drive some down the town's, you know, throat, you don't gonna have to do this. This is coming from the town, and this is from a position of wanting to get the town in a better position overall about affordable housing. Sir, add something to, you always remind me of all the things I forgot to say, so it's your,
you're
that's
good
your
so
job.
Far.
Good so far.
Why don't you define what affordable housing is?
Okay, thank you. You said you were going to remind me to do that. So affordable housing is defined as housing that takes, you can afford to live in your house if you're using less than 30% of your income for your housing costs. Now for folks, who are making plenty of money, you may choose to spend more than that because you want to live in a house that is fancier than you know, or you can afford. You have disposable income. But for folks who are in limited income, if they're spending more than 30% of their income on housing, that's putting a strain on their whole financial situation. So the federal government defines that certain levels of affordability. There's 50% of the area median income, 80% of the 70%, 80% of the area median income. We are in the Boston area, even though we're maybe closer to Worcester or closer to Fall River, if you like, but we are defined as in Stow as part of the Boston. So the median income is about $88,000 this year, approximately. 87, 88, I forget exactly what it is, but that's about, it's in that range. It was 84 last year, it went up a little bit. And so when we're talking about 80% or 50%, it's the household income being 50% of that number. So at 50%, it's 47, whatever that is, and 80%, it's, you know, 60-some thousand dollars. So it's not folks that are desperately poor necessarily, but folks that have middle income, but we're trying to make it the opportunity for folks to live in town and not spend more than 30% of their income on their housing situation. Is that...
I would add one more thing.
Yes.
We're very concerned about making sure that our affordable units actually count by the state. You heard references early to DHCD. That's the Department of Housing and Community Development. They're the ones who have to approve the units in order to put them on the list. Once it's on a list, they count towards our 10% goal as a community. Every community, all 351 communities in Massachusetts, has a goal of having 10% certified affordable housing on what we call the SHI, Subsidized Housing Inventory. So you're going to hear a lot of these acronyms, DHCD, SHI, 10% is really big. And the reason why, if you're not at 10%, that means developers can build large-scale development under what is state law Chapter 40B without having to really meet all of the local bylaws that we have. So they can, as long as 25% of those units are qualified for affordable housing recipients. Is that clear? So, like our golf courses, you know, they're not protected. So a developer could actually go into Stow Acres and build 400 units as long as 25% of them are affordable. And we as a town have very little right to say anything about that development. Okay? So what we're trying to do is take control and make sure that the town is building the affordable housing that we want as a town. Does that
help?
Okay. Thank you.
What's the percentage we're at right now?
7.1%. And by the way, this gets revised every 10 years with the census. So that's based on our 2010 census.
That's good.
I don't know if you've noticed, but there's been a little bit of growth since then in the community of Stow. And the population has increased and the number of units has increased. So I am very sure that if we do nothing, by the time 2020 rolls around, that's going to drop.
Or how many units do we need to get to 10%?
We need a lot. Having said that, your SMAHT, your housing trust, has spent a lot of time working on a housing production plan. And that is something that the state requires in order to count your progress. So we did a housing production plan. We updated it, submitted it to the state. They approved it. And that means we can do smaller incremental units and get what we call safe harbor, which means you can freeze or tell a 40B developer, nope, don't need you.
That's good for 2 years, is that correct?
And we actually did have safe harbor 2 years ago, when we did the expansion of plantation.
How close are we? How feasible is it that we will do that again in the facility?
Well,
do 11 units a year.
It's 12 to 13 units.
12 units.
If we had done all three opportunities that we had in the past 18 months, we would have met it. But two of those opportunities went away. So now we're on the third, but you never know, there's always more. Things pop up. So we need to keep proceeding.
As the housing market or the real estate markets, we've been trying to get our ducks in a row because we know that the housing market's going to, or it, we don't know, but we suspect that at some point it's going to pick up again. And that means some people are going to take lands out of chapter, and there's going to be opportunities. And some of those will be open space opportunities. Some of those may be a mixed opportunity with open space and housing or some other development. So the idea is to be ready for when those things happen so that we can address those things.
I will also add that I know the planning board has several conceptual and now definitive plans in front of them. And if you have six or more units in that plan, at least 10% of them have to be affordable. So that's going to help a little bit. I mean, they're still building more market rate units too, but at least it's going to keep us even as opposed to going backwards.
Just again, definition for
sure.
The folks here or perhaps watching later. Can you define what taking out a chapter means?
Oh, sure. So if anyone doesn't remember the last time we were doing this about Boxborough Road, there are lands that are protected in Chapter 61, and there can be agricultural or open space and
forestry,
right, part of agriculture, I guess. But in any case, the landowner pays a reduced rate of taxes while that property is in the chapter, in Chapter 61. And then when it's removed, when it's withdrawn from that program, the town has an option to buy those lands at meeting the same purchase and sale agreement that the landowner has received. So sometimes that's an option where it's affordable for the town, and sometimes if it's a large tract of land and it's going to be a large development, the town just doesn't have the resources to meet that. And often the clever developers make it so it inflates a bit so that the town it's out of the town's reach. But so that's an option. But realistically, those would be smaller developments. Those would probably be like in the range of 5 to 8 or something like that. But as Laura pointed out, even just 2 units or 5 units here, if those opportunities as they come up, we can build 2 here, 2 here, 2 here. That adds up. All we need is 11 in a given year to get a year of safe harbor, which means that somebody can't come in and ignore. They can still build, but they can't ignore our zoning, right? So with if you're under 10%, a 40B developer can pretty much ignore zoning.
Right, and the town actually has much more say. By the way, I just looked up the 2016 income limits for the town of Stow.
Yes, thank you.
$98,100 is the median income. So for 80% and a family of 4, that's $73,050. We're not talking poor people.
That's for 80%.
Mike, do you know if the golf courses are considered Chapter 61?
They are. One of them is.
Stow Acres is.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So there's a potential of selling one and keeping the other and
right.
Putting 400 houses.
I thought they all were except for the one on White Pond was not. I could be wrong.
I don't know. I think that one is. Well, I'm not going to guess.
There is plenty of open space.
There's risk.
There is risk. There are places that can be developed that would have a big impact. And so having control, and the idea is that we can't prevent those developments, but if we have safe harbor, if we make the 10%, and just as an educational thing, away a lot of towns, for instance, our neighboring town of, is it Bolton or Boxborough that just did the rental thing?
Boxborough.
Just put in a large rental development, and when you do rental developments, if 25% of them are affordable, you get to count all the units as toward your SHI. So if you build 100 units and there's only 25 affordable ones, you get credit for all 100.
What is SHI?
Oh, sorry, that's the subsidized housing inventory. That's the 10% that we need to get. So
this guy is vicious.
With
the acronym.
Well, I defined it.
No, I know. But I'm sorry. Thank you very much.
It's taken me months to understand what the heck.
What is that man talking about?
Really? I sometimes go.
I apologize.
What?
TV
I'm
land.
I'm going to hold you to the fire tonight.
But great. Okay. Yes, please do. Please do.
All the placard.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm learning.
I know we're talking about Pine tonight, but do we have a plan for 10, 12 to 13 a year?
So that's the housing production plan. And so there are certain criteria that we have to include. We try to say the different strategies that we're going to use to build affordable housing. And we have actually been implementing against them. It's just the town has decided not to choose to go in that direction. But that's part of our plan that we were trying to execute.
There is the part of our working with the Stow Community Housing Corporation, which they get all the credit for this because they take the risk and they do all the work, But they had the two projects, one for Pilot Grove Two and the other one for Plantation Two. Plantation Two had some issues with the permitting and stuff, and that is going to be resubmitted, and that's going to go through again. That's 30 units. That gives us a big chunk. If that gets approved and goes forward, that's good for the good of the whole town. I mean, that'll give us 2 full years of safe harbor, and put us down. Actually,
affordable units, if that happens.
Those are all affordable. Those are all. SCHC does only affordable rentals, so they do all affordable rentals. Even though they would only have to do a portion of it, they do. That's their business. They're a nonprofit for affordable housing. So, we're so lucky as a town to have a nonprofit within the town that does this, because many, many towns are trying to create that. It's very difficult now. The fact that this was created years ago and there's a track record of multiple developments means that they can get funding in situations when other towns can't. We're just trying to for the first time because they don't have a track record. So we're extremely lucky to have those folks working on these things. And you know, and we meet with them multiple times a year to say what their plans are, how can we address them. They've got a grant application that they're a loan or grant application the last time they
both.
Came to us.
Both.
That's right, both. They have had both and they've paid the loan back, which was one of the first loans in the state actually that Housing Trust made and got paid back on, which was interesting. But we didn't realize that we were breaking any ground there, but we actually loaned and got money back. So.
And I do want to add one more thing. When we talk about the subsidized housing inventory, notice the first word is subsidized. It's not the fact that you may have a low-cost house in town. It actually has to have a subsidy associated with it. So whether that comes from the town, like donation of land, or CPA funds, or if it comes from the state or the federal government, things like low-income tax credits, which right now may be at risk, the subsidy is really essential for the Department of Housing and Community Development to approve the unit on the list. Does that help?
And they have to have deed restrictions on it so that it's affordable, not just now, but going on in the future.
Now everyone's an expert, right?
Right. I'm sorry that we do have to, thank you, Don, for reminding us that we need to define these terms and stuff, because we get into this and...
We think we know what we're talking about.
We sound like we know what we're talking about. That's why I throw on running acronyms. So... we're thinking that maybe it would be useful to go through this timeline of what has happened up in the past with this particular property at Pine Point, just to kind of give a history of what's happened and bring us up to the current. And then we'd like to focus on what concerns. So the idea at this point is that there's not a final plan for what's going to happen. There's some preliminary plans. There's work that's been done, but where we are at this point, and also like to point out the other thing is that the SMAHT has put out an RFP that has been responded to by Habitat for Humanity of North Central Mass. Habitat is the developer at this point, and it's a friendly 40B, meaning that it's not something that, as I said earlier, is not something a developer coming and pushing down the throat. This was something we solicited, asked Habitat to come in, the town initiated this, and so the idea is that And knowing just as Habitat as an organization, we're trying to do is do what's best, what's going to be tolerated by the town, what's going to work out for everybody. So the idea, but clearly, although SMAHT is very supportive and we're advocating for this, at this point we are not the developer. It's Habitat's the developer, and we're a town entity, and we're having this. We want to have an open discussion with them. So just to make that point, we'll probably make it more times over the course of the evening. So the timeline is that we early on when we just were forming, one of the high priorities that the town asked us to do is look at all the town-owned land and see if there's any of the land that the town already owned that was suitable to put affordable housing. We started out, I think, about 11 parcels. A lot of them, there's good reason that the town had them, is because they were either underwater on a big big boulder in the center of it, or there was debris, essentially unbuildable. We got that down to about five, and that's when we, about 5 years, 5 years ago now? Oh my.
Yes.
Did you stick a look at this yet? When we hired Leonardo Ray, who's our housing consultant, who's a fine architect and has a lot of experience with affordable housing, and he works for us on a, you know, very part-time basis, but we needed somebody who had expertise in this area and could work with the different town and state entities that has experience in these things. And you started looking at, and we looked at the five that were the most likely and realized that only two were practical in terms of actually building homes. And at that point, we there was no real process, and Laura, you may, or anyone might want to speak about the process. There was no real process in town for how do we take a parcel that's owned by the town and decide to do something with it. There was really no procedure in place. So we drafted a process that was about 10 or 12 steps or whatever, and presented it to the Board of Selectmen and said, well, you know, we were thinking of using some of the land or investigating whether some of this land can be used. There is no procedure in place. What do you think of this procedure? And they looked through it and said they thought it was pretty good. And essentially what it amounts to is the Board of Selectmen ask all the committees and departments of town, is that, do you have any use for this land? And if they don't, then the idea is that then, if there's one group that does, the idea is that it's declared surplus, and then with the permission of town meeting, it can be transferred to one of the departments from the selectmen, and then the department can move forward with whatever its proposed use is. That's kind of it in a nutshell. Does anybody want to add to that? It's good enough. Yeah,
that's clear.
So we put that, we proposed the process, and it was approved by the Board of Selectmen. So we then initiated those requests for the two parcels of the Queens Lane and Pine Point. So that was in 2012. By the time everything worked out and it all happened, it was the 2013 annual town meeting where the I think it was Article 38 of that meeting was that they granted care, custody, and control to SMAHT for the purposes of building affordable housing, investigating and exploring whether that was going to be possible. And it was written such in a way that if it was indeed possible, that we wouldn't need to go back to town meeting, we wouldn't go back. The idea was that at that point, the idea was that this was SMAHT, you're in control of this, and if you can build housing there, please do. And that was what that article, the way it was written, and it was approved. So we begin.
Mike, was it a close vote? Do you remember?
No, it was not. It was. I think it was unanimous. Actually, I think it was unanimous.
Thank you.
But I don't quote me. I think it was.
I don't remember counting.
Don't remember counting. That's right. He's a teller. So we started initial engineering studies just to see whether there was any possibility of, and it turned out both parcels perked pretty well the first time that we were. You want to explain percolation testing? Please,
yeah,
go ahead.
The environmental.
Yeah, was tested for its ability to support a septic system.
Thank you. And this is the person to ask.
Can you introduce yourselves?
No, we said we were going to do that and we forgot to. Who was supposed to remind me to introduce ourselves? All right. I was supposed to do it.
Starting with yourself.
So, my name is Mike Kupchinski. I'm on 12 Canterbury Road. I'm the chair of this trust.
I'm Ingeborg Hageman on Carrington Way, and I'm the newest and most confused member, but I'm learning.
And a select.
Oh, yeah.
I'm Cynthia Perkins. Red Acre Road. I'm been with the Housing Trust, and also I'm the local project committee of Habitat for Humanity. It has just been in formation.
Quince Papanas to see you, Hudson Road. I think I'm one of the original members of the trust. I haven't figured out an exit strategy yet.
And Laura Spear on Forest Road, and I've been involved in town government for a while.
A long time.
And former selectman.
Former selectman.
Mm-hmm. And finance committee.
Planning board.
Planning board. She's done it all.
Thank you, Doug. So we did initial studies, could you explain why we did, I can't remember why we did a second round. I think the idea was, we originally thought that the houses
on Pine Point, they did perk test first on the lower portion of the site, And it wasn't that successful.
It was like two bedrooms or something.
Yeah, and then they went back and checked in the upper part of the site. That's why we went back twice. Well, the engineer went back twice.
Right.
And it was Stamsky and Mary were the engineers.
So we went through a small procurement process to select the engineers and solicit services.
And they did both? They did both parcels?
They do both parcels. They walked the parcel. They did some topo maps and identified key things on the site. I visited the Board of Health to look at the location of the existing wells and septics, and they're also looking to that. So just some generic site capacity information.
Right. No specific, not going to be designed a septic?
Yeah,
like that,
just to know if the site could
appropriate to the stage of development we were at. Yes?
What date was the perk done that passed?
The first one, it probably was in 2015, 14. And then the second one around 16, the last one last year or this one.
In the summer?
Yes, we actually had to wait. There was a one point when we realized that it was worth going back to do additional tests, that it was like December, and we had to wait all the way to June.
So June of 2016?
Yes, I believe
that's
it was.
That's the one that
it passed. Was with the RFP, Caroline, those tests, so I cannot remember the date. It was 15 or 2016?
I think it was 15.
I think it was 15.
Okay.
I think it was 15
yeah.
as well. It wasn't just this past year.
Right. It wasn't just this past year because
we put the RFP out this year. Right. It was the year before that.
And the perk test tells us how many units,
how many bedrooms
can be built.
Supported, right. And that was five, I think the number was five.
The number of five.
Was five,
yeah.
And
it's a common, they call it between four and eight, you know, it's all depends
right.
the type of system and,
right.
and there's another formula about counting other acreage around, so but it's still a ballpark at that time.
Right. So we have made a decision pretty early on. The idea is that because it's a sensitive location around the lake and stuff, that we'd be on the low end of that. When we put out the RFP, the idea was to focus on four bedrooms, so it would be a duplex with two bedroom units, and so that we would make sure that we weren't pushing at all the capacity to land. The idea would be that we'd well within the tested, and you know, this was off the data, wasn't off of a, you know, we weren't just, you know, guessing. We actually got data. Pardon me?
What was the date in August of the RFP?
I'm sorry, I don't have that. Do you have it with you there?
Somewhere
you may have it.
Yeah. August 2016, I believe.
I think
it was the later part of August.
Yeah, I think the deadline was September.
Actually, the bullet down here says August 2016.
I know.
Yeah, but that's what we're looking for, the actual date. I think it was
the actual date.
If I guess, it was 20.
Yeah, we'll have to go back. It was posted on the central register, so there's clear records.
There's records in the state for when that was done.
And then when did you hear back? How many proposals did you receive?
We get exactly one proposal.
And how long, what date was that response of the proposal?
So if I've got the latest version here, and there was two. So the RFP was officially available September 7th. There was a briefing session on September 13th. The deadline for questions was September 20th. Answers were provided by September 23rd. Proposals were due October 11th by 2 p.m. and 60 days to selection.
That is your question?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We can go back and check the record on the central register. We also have to do a legal notice in the paper, so all that is there.
It's troublesome to me that the process. You let the neighbors know on September 20th, so well after the RFP was submitted. And it was submitted with just a small number of bedrooms, was the terminology. And I don't know why they think 48. I'm not sure that's small.
And again, the idea of sending out an RFP is not something that you would normally let people know about that. The idea is that it is a public thing. we took the extra step of letting people know that this was going on, because we wanted to make sure that everybody understood that this was a process that was going on, that we wanted input. So it's not something that's required, it's to let people, it's to let anybody know that you're doing an RFP. It's part of the, but it was kind of an extra step that we said we wanted to make sure that we started to engage the community in the process.
And where the neighbors were invited.
Yeah.
To come to our meeting.
Right, we said, we got the better, we got the usual butters list that you would, we went to the assessor's office and asked for the butters list.
Which you weren't required to do, but you did.
We weren't required to do, because that's not required, it's farther down, that's like when you're getting to the permitting process. We weren't required to do the, get the assessor's, but we wanted to make sure early on in the process. So we asked for the, we asked for the butters list from the assessors, the same one that would be sent out under regular conditions. They just give you a list, you know, they just give you a bunch of stickers, and you put it, you know, write your letter, and you send off what you like. So, so we sent those letters off to folks. We put, we did a interview in the paper, and that was published. We also did a letter to the editor, like, try to let as many people around the town know what was coming and what was going on, so that we could have input. Any other questions? So that kind of brings us up to where, so we selected, and the way in an RFP, what you do is you just go through the RFP and you say, here are the certain requirements, and you just first make sure that any respondent meets all the basic requirements. And if that's the case, if you have more than one, you then compare and look at within that what meets the goals of the RFP better after you've decided which of the respondents meet the bare minimum, you do the required thing. And then, you know, if there's, you know, it could be funding, it could be expertise, so there's a number of past success. In this case, there was only one respondent, so we felt that rather than just accept that, we needed to make sure that we were following a process that we would follow with anybody, with any developer, and that was to ask for references, to go back. We asked questions, in the RFP, we asked for references. We checked with a number of towns where Habitat had done these developments before, and we have pretty glowing recommendations of working with this group. And so we felt that pretty comfortable that this was gonna be, that there was a good track record and of sensitive and development and long-term commitment to the folks who move there. A good selection process to make sure the people who move into these homes are committed, financially vetted, but also that we know that Habitat from the other towns have told us that Habitat will stay involved with these people as they are in their home. If there's things come up later, or if there's, I don't know, if there's financial situation, whatever it is, the Habitat will stay with folks and keep working with them. One of the other advantages is that a lot of the funds are raised privately. So in terms of the amount that the town has to put in to build these units, which is often a higher subsidy because much of this is privately raised, it actually ends up being a fairly good deal for the town in terms of the subsidy that's put in how units are provided for how much money we have to put in.
Does the value of the land that the town owned, does that count as part of the subsidy?
It could.
It should. It does. It does in terms of the paperwork with the state. Yes. It does. Absolutely. And that is the, you know, as we said, you know, that is a big part of the subsidy is the land. I mean, that is, you know, of course this was land that's the town's owned for 50 years with no tax, you know.
Do you recall what the value was for that purpose, the paperwork process?
No, there's no an actual dollar amount.
There's no appraisal required.
So how do you get credit for a match if you don't know what your, there's no number?
We use the assessor. The assessor.
Just the assessor. Oh, simple. Okay. Do you know what that number was, roughly?
I don't remember. It wasn't really. I mean, the number, no, we didn't. It wasn't okay. Something. It wasn't something we were focused on.
The DHCD, it's kind of a check.
Yeah, yes. The DHCD is mostly, you know, the town takes the action to provide the land is sufficient,
which we did at town meeting.
Right. Exactly.
In 2013. Right.
Thank you.
Question.
Yes.
There's a development right adjacent to this land called Bloom Heights. There is a development.
houses were built there. I'm not quite sure exactly when, but say 15 years ago, 15 years ago. At that time, I just had occasion to visit there. I was interested in local real estate, what was happening. And the broker told me that the land that is in question tonight is was never going to be developed by the town. So my question was, why didn't you offer to this developer, why didn't you make an arrangement with this developer to try to have an agreement? In other words, you could have negotiated affordable housing in. What was wrong with the land? Why didn't he want it? And why didn't you give it to him?
Frankly, 15 years ago, there was no, besides the Housing Authority, which was really just focused on administering Section 8 federal vouchers, there was really, 15 years ago, no active housing advocacy group in town. Had that might have been an option at that time. Certainly, I wasn't involved with things at that point.
It may not have been that long ago, but you're not familiar with it. That
not
Boone Heights is right next to the land in question.
And based on my tenure on the planning board, that was before me.
That was before you.
In any event, the RFP is issued publicly. It's advertised in the papers, put on the central register. I would think that if there were other developers that would see the potential for this site, they would have picked the.
You mean at the time when that was done?
Historical interest, because this land was transferred. The deed was from Hanson's. Hanson's, it seemed, 1950s, 1960s,
yeah,
we were talking. I don't know the whole history, but it seemed to be a relative of his, it might have been his wife, and basically it was, it could be 40 years ago this land was given to the town of Stow. And so
given
it's
or taken?
Just,
it was tax title taken.
Yeah, yeah, it was, they couldn't pay the taxes. So it's just very odd that all of a sudden it's just, we have to develop this and on this timeline. I had a favor, I don't mean to speak too much, but it's really kind of late. I do have some comments, and I know there's a lot of people that I think want to comment. I wonder if we could switch now to the public speaking comments.
Well, I was hoping that
we personally would like to hear the rest of the time.
Yeah, let's get
yes.
the time.
So let's maybe abbreviate it a little bit and get to the comments as soon as possible,
yeah.
and that's fair. It's fair if we're taking too much time. So, So the process from now on is that essentially once a proposal is going to be brought, we look for input from different parts of the town, planning board, conservation commission, board of health, and look for potential issues, look for their feedback about how to make this appropriate. Also looking out to the community, this is first steps now. the torch is going to be passed very shortly to Habitat for those discussions as the responsible developer, and kind of this is look at this kind of right now we're in this transition of where we're handing off the RFP we've been chosen. We're about to enter into a purchase and sale agreement contingent on a number of issues of funding and other things and permitting, etc. And then it's going to be really Habitat that's going to be doing this.
Can you identify
yes.
The face with.
Yes, we could. We were about to ask. That's why I was kind of making that thing. Is that Carolyn Reed is the executive director of North Central Massachusetts Habitat, and I mean maybe it's time for because we're getting into the part of the timeline here where Habitat is going to be taking the lead. Maybe would you like to talk about how you see the rest of the process in or at this point or.
Yeah, so
do you want to move up here so the cameras can see you and
the cameras can see you everywhere.
Right, knowing.
So now that we've worked together with SMAHT and we looked at all the plans they had, we have started looking at some provisional plans for developing the site. And the first thing we'd like to do when moving into a town is to start a local project committee. So we have started it. We've had two meetings.
Can anybody
local
hear?
Project.
Beer heard. All right.
We've had two meetings of the local project committee, and the goal with having a local project committee is that the town's involved, because this is a townwide effort. That Habitat has all of the structure to be able to do this, but we want to do it in conjunction with the town. So that's where we are. So we'll move forward with the agreements, that we have, and then we'll check with the planning boards. We've got an architect helping us with it.
What's the mechanism for putting together your community input group?
So we put flyers out for the local project committee, and we sent notes out to anyone we knew in town to invite them.
That has been done.
Yes, so we started, anyone can join at any time.
And have you had significant response or
any response? We had great response, yeah. I think we had 15 at the first meeting, about 20 at the second meeting. So we've had great response. And we set up a structure within the local project committee. We have a chair, a treasurer, a secretary, someone to help with volunteer coordination, two people to help us with construction.
These are all folks from Stow?
From Stow, yeah. Although we did have a couple from other towns surrounding Stow who are just interested in being part of the Habitat for Humanity process. Right. And we do have a full-time construction manager who will oversee any development, but part of the way we keep our housing costs low is to use volunteer labor to help build the house.
Jimmy Carter coming to town?
I just saw him last week. I'll invite him. I'll see.
Let him a boat ride.
It's all this far. It's all this far.
Tell him not to ride.
Okay.
Oh, now the
bottom of my own book.
So I think it's fine to open up. We'd love to hear any feedback. We got some great feedback last night from the neighbors that we're taking into account already. I met with our site planning committee again today to take into account the feedback we've gotten and some of the challenges with geography and geology of that particular lot.
Great. So, Janet, since you had some comments that you want to make, I would invite you to at this point.
Anybody has more priorities for leaving, I can stay. I thought it would be, you know, we have gone an hour and a half. Does anybody want to speak first, or I'll go? Okay. I'll go. Okay to come up?
Sure.
Sure. Yeah.
Thanks, Scott. The cameras are everywhere.
Everywhere.
Stay seated where you are, if you wish.
How much time do I have? 5 minutes?
Essentially, I think it may, if you have a statement, it would be one thing.
5 minutes.
If you have a question, this is an appropriate time for questions, at this point, and we can answer that, and then I think that, like, if it's a real statement, like you've prepared, I don't know if that's necessarily...
I have a 5 minute statement, but I just wanted to see if I had time to thank you for your work, because I really appreciate what you're doing for your work all these late nights, and thank you for what you do for the town, all volunteers. So my name is Janet Stiles, 58 Pine Point Road, and I'm going to start off with... refer to the 2010 Stow Master Plan. And in the plan, the A number one district to consider restricting building permits for was in their opinion, in their decision, the Lake Boone area. Okay, and I quote from that 2010 Stow Master Plan. The planners felt that, quote, it was a necessary step the town will have to take to protect the health and the resources of the residents presently dwelling in this neighborhood. So I'd like to share my concerns and also suggest alternatives, positive alternatives. I don't want to be negative all the time. But I have some genuine environmental concerns. One of them is the hillside would have to be cleared of trees and bushes, otherwise any septic system would be at risk for all the roots. If the natural landscape is destroyed, then the slope would become more unstable than it is already, likely to have severe erosion, landslides, and flooding. This leads to potential danger to the groundwater, heavy stormwater runoff, and the risk of damage to wells. And this can push people into untenable situations and lead to legal recourse against the town. There's a recent Massachusetts lawsuit which was filed successfully by a resident against the town of Stow because of concerns about his well safety under a proposed affordable housing development, the Plantation Complex. And the town committee that heard it, the Zoning Board of Appeals, waived existing zoning regulations, as is their right by law. It's kind of to protect people just from not wanting something in the neighborhood. Anyway, this case went up through the appeals courts. The appeal court judge ruled against the town of Stow and agreed that there was insufficient evidence to show that the groundwater would be protected under the nonprofit's proposal. What the judge said is that
the potential risk of damage to private wells did exist, and that although affordable housing need did exist, that the public health was more important than affordable housing. These lawsuits cost everybody in Stowe a lot of money, and I know there was a little glib discussion about that, oh, well, let's just throw $1,500 here or this amount there. But at last week's selectmen's meeting, the town administrator described the increase in town's legal fees this year as uncommonly high. So situations which suck us into poorly conceived plans should be conscientiously avoided. And there are very good alternatives. A neighbor at the last meeting of the selectmen mentioned the highway barn. I think there's a lot of merit to that. And my suggestion, I keep you in suspense. This is about the best idea I think I've ever had about anything. I think this is the greatest idea ever. And I think you're going to love this idea.
I can't wait to hear it.
All right. So my suggestion is the adaptive reuse of the town fire station. This revitalizes an existing building. It supports all the principles of modern best practices of municipal planning. It's central. The kids can walk to school. Good for health, reduce childhood obesity. They can walk to the playgrounds. They can walk to the library. There's no destruction of nature. There's plenty of space. There's plenty of parking. And maybe my favorite part, we save millions of dollars on future capital expense burden on the taxpayers in Stowe by not having to do something to ourselves to this building. So in conclusion, I'm going to refer, and thanks for hearing me out,
you've been
very patient.
Thank you.
I'll refer to the Stowe Master Plan 2010. And these people, many of them are kind of duplicate on town committees that are in this room. And they saw the future. They saw the future. And they said they advocated the concept of building reuse. And quote, Stowe has, this is a quote from the plan, Stowe has municipal buildings that will become obsolete as new schools are built and older buildings replaced, and we should reuse them. They recommended, in addition, low impact development. They recommended not disturbing natural habitat and reducing impervious areas. Those are those areas which are going to be forced to be on that very small area on the end of Pine Point Road. It's going to have to be paved and retaining walls and trees, as I said, it got to go. Anyway, this is straight out of the master plan, and I think that we should look at alternatives. It's really not so much on Pine Point Road about affordable housing or other housing. It's about building. I think everybody's in favor of affordable housing. Everybody wants to help people. It's very good charity. It's a very worthy cause. But I think that this is not thought out well, and I don't think you have room for it. Thanks so much.
Yep. Thank you. Thank you for the concerns. Brought up some new things. Just so you, I hope you'll be happy about this, but we've already expressed interest in both the highway barn and the fire department, mm-hmm. as well as there's another as things move. There's a group called the Municipal Land or the Municipal Building Committee mm-hmm. that's being headed up by Doug Hyde that is looking at all the municipal needs. For the housing, and those two parcels are actively being looked at, and we've raised our hands for both of them. So, so we'd like to do. It's really not an either or situation. Every opportunity that comes up, we're going to investigate, and those are two that are going to come up as well. So, thank you for your comments. Other comments? I'm sure there are.
Well, she raised some points that I think could be kind of turned into questions.
Well, that can be, you can raise points as you will. Whatever you want to say. Okay. We're here to hear what you want
to
say.
I'm going to turn them into questions. So she spoke of the environmental impact and the erosion from the hill. And these are really, I'm in a butter, by the way. And I know we have some serious drainage issues. We have a retaining wall, at least two. And they have spouts that just spew water, and it's right. not enough.
Yeah. What spews water? I'm sorry.
The spouts coming out of
the spouts.
Our retaining walls. We've had serious drainage issues, and I'm wondering how those are really going to be dealt with if anybody has been out to the site that knows how to deal with these and can possibly foresee how that's going to be dealt with. It's a crazy area.
Yeah, we heard that last night.
Right, you know, new crowd.
No, I'm not saying you shouldn't say it again, because you should. So, as I said last night, we were building off the great work that you guys did with Stamsky and McNary and all the plans that you had. And we have two civil engineers on our board who looked at those plans and continue to look at the land itself and have a lot of experience in doing this. So they've already come up with some really cool looking and neat ways to add retaining walls into the hill that would be behind the house. And so all this feedback is awesome to get them about how that works and all the water that's there and what we would need to take into account.
Are those plans something that we can see?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
Yes. I mean, all along the way.
It's great that their property wouldn't flood, but diverting that water somewhere else means.
Right.
No, absolutely.
We're putting your yard.
Right. And my well.
Right. Guys, so right. We like our neighbors, your neighbors,
right.
And
like
want to
too.
Have great neighbors, and so we have to make sure that we make great neighbors for you.
Okay. Is there at any point, like, I don't know, if you go in there and you find that this is not a good idea anymore, like, I don't know, hit that point, or are we past that? Like, we're going to pump money into this until it works.
No.
That's kind of.
We can't do that. We're not.
I don't know where the money would come from, right? Where the money would come from, we don't know.
That seems like kind of like it's not a green property. I don't think anybody wants to argue that. Like, it's the side of a hill, there are trees all
it's
over
totally
it.
Totally a habitat.
Well, yeah, you were saying it's a habitat property. Yeah. That's no fun. But I mean, like, how much money is too much money? And we'll continue
to analyze that all along. So that's the civil engineers we have are fantastic, and they do this all over the state. And as they said this morning, they have a lot of experience because in a lot of places, this is the land that's left to try to do something with. So we'll continue to analyze it, and I hope by the next LPC meeting, we'll have something even more to look at. Yeah, but absolutely. There would be a point that if it's just too expensive, we're not able to do it.
And when does that happen? Like, when are the costs adjusted and like the new plans put on? You know what I mean? When does everybody kind of get access to that?
So as I said, hopefully in the next LPC meeting, I can update you on where we are on that. When we did the initial budget, the civil engineers were involved in that budget.
Okay.
So I did my budget and brought it to him. He's like, "How is this?" So he gave me some sanity and a lot more information around that budget. So we'll keep doing that as we move along. So for the initial RFP, they went out and looked at it. They looked at all the plans, and they'll now continue to do that. Go do more work on the land. But we had some great reports to go from. We had the perk tests and all the results and where the test pits were done and exactly where a septic could be placed, where a well could be placed based on everything around it. So we had some great information to go on that made us feel comfortable coming to this point, and then we'll continue looking at it with as much input as we can get.
Please.
My name is Elsie Rodney, and I'm from Pine Court. Wrote a piece. My concern is the whole septic issue, and it occurs to me that a two-bedroom house means it's a two-bedroom house. How many people get to live in each bedroom? And that would, the septic system needs it to be two people. But you know what I mean? Is there a way that it could be restricted? For instance, something like over 55 housing that's not apt to have kids. Parties, you know, just to think, talking about toilet use.
Right.
If it gets, is there some way it could be restricted? And if so, does that negate it as affordable housing? I mean, I'm sure there's a whole lot.
There's some dicey issues about age restriction, at about even for the couple of adult active neighborhoods we have. There are some federal issues that some questions about. Adult active neighborhoods in general. So every town would love to build every new house as a 55 plus because it means they can build and get more taxes and not have any more school kids. So there's the state and the feds like, oh, we know that story. So essentially they're on the lookout for those kinds of things. But one of the reasons that when we did the test and we saw we were at the 4 to 8 range, that we are really one of the reasons we stayed at the lower end of bedrooms. And these things are sized by bedrooms with an assumption is that there's not going to be 40 people in a bedroom. It's, you know, 2 people per bedroom kind of thing. So there's 4 people in a house. Also, in terms of the size of the house, this is about 1,200 square feet? What's the?
No, it's less than that.
Less than that.
Between 1,000 and 1,100 square feet right now.
For each unit.
For each unit. Each unit. Right. Yeah, each right. of the units of that size.
Right. So these both units are going to be smaller than a lot of house. I mean, than a lot of modest houses that are in the neighborhood.
But close to the size of this roof. 1,000 square
feet. Yep. The size of Don's boat is Steve points out. Or maybe the party boat, right?
And I, you know, as I understand it, the actual
use. So Board of Health, part of the requirements for our septic system is that it'll be designed larger than the use that would normally be generally applied in the residents in the house. So they don't have a pocket, it doesn't have a septic system.
They're designed by number of bedrooms, basically, not by number of habitants.
Right.
But they already account
for.
That's
what my right. question is if it's a design by, you know.
So it's they can't have. Little excess capacity. It's overbuilt.
It is overbuilt.
They're typically something like half a dam as large. I don't know exactly.
And again, this is probably going to be some sort of active septic system, I suspect. So. Meaning that it has a little higher, even higher standard. It's an enhanced system. It's an enhanced. Can somebody explain what an enhanced?
Enhanced system. I don't know if that's what she's proposing.
Rock filters or what?
Yeah, I don't think we're there yet.
Not yet there yet.
Yeah, I'm not. Yeah.
Right.
And I wouldn't want the site guy here, the civil engineer, talking about it because I'm just getting myself into trouble.
Yeah. Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
So.
The quick word on that is that it has 2 tanks, so that the material is processed twice before it hits the leach field instead of once. A typical system has 1 tank. Mm-hmm. That type of system is more efficient because it has 2 tanks, so everything gets processed more before.
Was that with the rock filter in between?
That's what the rock system is.
But to further answer your question, generally with it, we don't. Generally have more than 2 people in the bedroom.
We have any way of
Well, we do because
our overnight
the restrictions.
No, I'm saying for the family that's selected
so
to live
pick
in this house.
A family of 12.
Right.
No, because then they'd need another house because they'd still have a need. This would be satisfying their need. And we do follow DHCD guidelines, so it will be open to everyone to apply for that home. Generally, a 2-bedroom home lends itself to a small family or an aging-in-place situation.
Is there a local preference?
That's not up to me. That's up to the town.
And that's very tough right now. DHCD is really cracking down on local preference. You have to show all kinds of data validating, and it's up to 60%. So of the 2 units, 1 could be for local preference, but it's really unlikely at this point. You actually have to submit something like a 20-page document in order for them to even evaluate it.
Just an opinion that one of the things we keep talking about is we have young employees in the highway department,
right.
And they can't afford to live in town.
If we can provide the data to support that, the statistics.
But they don't live in town now, but
if
you want them to.
If we can provide the data and the statistics of how many people live out of town versus in town,
right.
And what their
income
levels
anybody
are.
Employed in town, family members of people in town, these are all people considered with local ties. So in a local initiative program, it's not just people living here, but people with relatives living here, people working here. People who grew up here and don't live here anymore, that kind of stuff. So all those people are included in a local plan when you have them.
So
it's really hard to do for a 2-unit.
Yeah, we would need to provide the application to DHCD to get approval for local preference, is the story I'm saying.
And a separate approval besides all the other approvals from DHCD.
But it might be a benefit of people that probably move out of Stow, doesn't live here anymore, and now they will have the same preference if they were living here.
And they can still apply.
Oh,
they can still apply. Exactly.
Just don't wait.
And again,
so the local preference may not actually work to meet that benefit, actually.
Okay, thank you.
So I know this is about the actual property, but I had a question about the process that you guys go through in terms of, you know, people applying to live here and the selection process. You're not just like You've got a process. Could
we
you
do.
Maybe describe the
Absolutely.
Process just a little bit so that folks could have an idea that maybe alleviate some of the concern about 12 people living in a single bedroom?
Absolutely. So we do have a process. Generally, we open the family selection process when we're permitted. So generally, right before when we're starting to build, we open the selection process, and we follow the marketing agreement from DHCD. So we advertise the application process. We have several information meetings at several different times to accommodate different schedules, and we will do personal information meetings if required for the family. So that's how we start, and they come to an information meeting, or we tell them about the application process. There are three criteria to be a Habitat homeowner. The first is income, so the family has to have an income, generally between 30 and 60% of area median, but we can go up to 80% of area median income. And in Acton, we did go up to 80%, but generally our homeowners are 30 to 60% of area median income. The second criteria is that they have a willingness to partner. So the partner family, if it's a single parent family, will put in 200 hours of sweat equity into helping build the house. That two parent family will put 350 hours. So that shows commitment to the house that they're going to be moving into. The other benefit is it helps them learn how to maintain their house. So if you're helping to build it, if you're helping to put in the floor, put in the drywall, see the electric going in, it helps them learn how to maintain a house, because this is a first-time home buyer program. And the third is need. So each family will be evaluated based on their need for a new housing situation. So need is assessed based on safety, security, size, and health.
After 10 years from now, they're making more money, they're doing better, they own the house?
So they will have a mortgage that they will have to pay off. It's a zero interest mortgage. So the mortgage payment itself will never go up. We do escrow for taxes and insurance.
Right, but they bought the house.
Yes.
20 years from now, they bought the house.
Yes, they own the house.
And then they move away, they sell it.
So there then is, there's that? A deed restriction. So there's a deed restriction.
It becomes affordable.
Yes, so it needs to be sold to someone. So generally, what the homeowner would receive if they sold it is about the equity they put in. The house cannot be flipped to make money.
And it doesn't turn into something, whatever.
And the goal with this entire program, with the whole Habitat program, is to break the cycle of poverty. So we do want the payment to stay roughly the same. We know taxes, insurance will go up a little bit. We want the payments to stay exactly the same so homeowners can save for retirement, for education, for their health care costs. So we can break that cycle.
Thanks. What type of mortgage would you be talking about for this size of these size units?
So it a little bit depends. We used to set our mortgage based on the cost to build a house, and now we set our mortgage based on affordability for the homeowner. So our mortgage can go up to 40 years to make sure it's affordable for the homeowner that is selected. And we want to make sure, again, that their payments are 30% or less. Now we price the house based on the appraised value, and the mortgage will be based on what the homeowner can afford, and we hold a silent second between the two. So the appraised value means that it won't impact the prices of any of your homes, because it'll show that as the sales price. It'll be the appraised value. The mortgage will be what they can afford, and the silent second we write down over years, but in essence it becomes a second deed restriction. So if they try to sell it, and for some reason that deed restriction didn't hold, which I don't, won't be the case here, because the DHCD, but then that second mortgage comes due.
I'm just wondering, just for, can you give a number though for a monthly, if you have an average person for the, that needs 50%, what kind of money would you be talking?
So if you're looking on average, so say the mortgage they can afford is like $150,000, you're looking about $850 a month for their payment.
Do they pay taxes
then? Oh yeah. Oh yeah. And that amount would include taxes. We escrow for taxes and insurance. And we hold the mortgage. Habitat holds the mortgage, but LCU very kindly services our mortgages for us. So we fall under all the mortgage guidelines of any other mortgage holder.
So you said 800 includes the taxes?
And insurance.
And you mentioned that homeowners, they were talking about having them have a homeowners association. That presumably would include their homeowners' dues
so
as well?
Yes, so they will have a condo association because it will be a shared well and septic. And because the property will be adjoining, the two homes will be adjoining. So there will be a condo association. This will be
common
the fourth.
Wall construction.
What?
Common wall construction.
Yes, yeah. Yeah. So this will be the fourth time in the last 3 years we've done this.
Steve, are they paying the late tax or some charge tax for the town?
I would presume yes.
The assessment.
Yeah. That's part of the
assessed value, which is the affordable value.
The affordable value.
Right. But right. They're
the
eligible taxes. they're liable for any taxes that anybody in that position would be. So yes.
Who owns the land? Right.
Oh, it's a condo association.
The association would own the land.
Right.
So like any condo association.
Yeah. The homeowners.
They own a percentage of the land, in this case it would
percentage of the corporation that owns the land.
Presumably 50% each.
And do they have like a condo board?
Well, each unit owner would be a trustee.
Two trustees.
It's the two of them. Right. They will have a formal condo association document.
There'll be a master deed recorded, bylaws.
Nothing
gets done. That sort of thing.
Caroline, does Habitat get involved at all as part of being a trustee, at least temporary? I've seen that in other situations where, you know, the developer or the agency providing is a trustee for a given period of time. Is that something?
Yes, and in certain cases, mm-hmm. with certain homeowners, right. I'm still on some of the documents.
Okay.
Yeah, or not me, but Habitat. Yeah.
Right. Could that help someone?
Yeah. And we also tell the homeowners anytime there is a dispute, we're here to help.
Right.
We're here to help mediate. We can bring other people to help mediate. And we haven't had it yet. We've all been great and liked working together.
Condo docs are all kind of standardized now. And there's an arbitration agreement within the condo docs. There's rules about maintenance of the units. There's rules about architectural controls so that one guy can't paint his unit pink and the other one bright blue. You know, so there's
any changes to the structure.
You know, it's no different than all the two families in Worcester and Somerville and Arlington that have been converted to condos. It's just like that. It's a two-unit condo.
On the condo, I always thought you owned the space, but not the house.
Yes, they own the unit, and then they own the
and they share
areas.
The land.
Right.
And there can be, you know, they can have exclusive rights to the left half of the land versus the right half of the land.
I own the condo.
You know all about it.
Excuse me if I ask a question coming into this process late. But I've been around the lake for a lot of years. And knowing the configurations, the topography of that lot that's been referenced, what about where is the parking? And is that how much land is left over? I mean, you're not building this up on mountain goat land on the side of the hill, you're building it on the flat portion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What about how much parking is allowed? Is it two cars for each unit?
So that's how we're designing it. It's two cars, and we're playing around a lot with how we exactly place the houses and how we build the houses to make sure that we have space. Yeah, it is. It's tight.
And
that's
is there a yard? Sorry. Is there any green space?
There will be some the way we're doing it. Yeah, there will be some, and the retaining walls will help us to do that. And then they'll have the wooded land up top to go plant.
I would also add, go upstairs into the planning board conference room. We have maps all over the place of town. And there's one of Lake Boone. And I took a little picture of it just because I was wondering about the scale. I don't know if you guys can see my little itty bitty phone, but this is the parcel here. And these are all the other neighboring parcels. So I think there's going to be plenty of green space. You know, it may not be buildable, but the parcel itself that we're talking about is probably the size of four or five of the abutting parcels. So go upstairs in your copious free time in that planning board.
Actually, I have that on my, if everybody really wants to see it, I have it on my thumb drive that I can project later if anybody's interested. But it really is the biggest, your plot is about half the size. You're the triangle piece,
yeah.
Right? Yeah. So your piece is about half the area. And there's a lot of other pieces, and there's really nothing on that road that's even close to the size of this parcel.
Right, but a majority of that is not black.
Oh, right, but it's still, but it's still green.
Green space.
Yeah. It's still green space, that's right.
But my kids go out and play, they're not going to climb a hill. That's not what I mean by green space.
Well, when they get
sure. Not right now. Not right now. They will.
Your
kids.
Okay, so I lied.
My
kids
are
playing.
We don't want to give them any ideas here either. Okay, there
you go. So yes, you have room for the cars, but like, I don't know, I think the whole point of this is to like, I don't know, do good, and you want, I don't know, make this right. A great property, and that's the whole goal, and like, shoving cars in there, and then like, looking at it, where are they going to put two units in that little space, and have like, any kind of door, or have it look, I don't know, I just did that.
That's what the experts are for.
Plans, yeah.
I know,
right, yeah.
But
this
I haven't
is,
seen
we do
any,
this a lot.
Yeah. Like, the plans I've seen, it's just like, I'm just looking at it, it just looks so jammed in there. And the fact that you have to stick a septic up the hill and pump yuck uphill and then like that worry. And all my things are downhill. I'm just worried about overflow and coming into my well.
I think you said we want to make a project that everybody's going to be proud of, that doesn't endanger anyone, doesn't endanger anyone's health, it doesn't create any problems for anybody, and that we have people who are going to be great neighbors moving in that you're going to be proud to live next to. That's the goal, right? That's the goal. And that's the ideal. The worst thing that happens is not that we don't build here, because I think that's, if it turns out that we can't build here in that way, then we don't want to. And the worst thing is that we build something that doesn't work for the people who live there or for the neighbors or whatever. That's the worst case, and we're going to avoid that because that's why we're asking for community input. Mm-hmm. We want to know all the concerns now before the plans are finalized so that we come when these plans come through, it all makes sense. We've all had a chance to weigh in on it, and it's somebody say, okay, you know, this isn't maybe my favoriteest thing in the world, but I can understand that we have a need. And in terms of the green space, I think the other thing to compare it to is where these people might be coming from, and this may be the most green space they've, you know, they like, this is great, you know, compared to what, who knows what their current situation is. So, you know, I don't put myself in their position. You know, this is going to be offered to people to buy, and if they decide, you know, if they decide to buy it because they want to, it's, we're not going to force them, you know, I mean. People who don't want to live there won't live there. You know,
they won't apply.
Right? They won't apply. Yeah. The people who want to go here are the people who want to live there, right?
But we want them to be successful and happy. So we
can. Please.
Yes. So just to clarity, and again, applaud everybody's efforts on this. Why a duplex then? So if the idea is to offer the opportunity and in such a, you know, it's a non-conforming space for one house. And help me understand then why a duplex, especially if it perked in the lower spot where you're not pumping sewage so far up for two bedrooms. Help me understand.
Well, so, you know, you could build a single five-bedroom house there, which would be a big house. You know, I mean, that would be, I mean, you could, for in terms of the septic area, it could be. So
let me clarify. So you said earlier that initially for two bedrooms, and then by changing
it didn't perk at the lower level
because it's wet. That lower level is
right,
wet. It didn't
then
perk.
The second test was giving between 4 to 8 bedrooms possible
with the pumping.
So when you said both sites, one per.
No, it's one site. We're always talking about one site.
We're
two
talking
properties.
About
two bedrooms. That's right. I was right.
Right.
Originally, then we're
so
talking
now,
Queens
you
Lane
have
and
four
Pine
bedroom,
Point.
You can have two and two. It doesn't matter if it's in separate units. It's the total number of bedrooms. But you can do three and one.
But right, we could do three and one.
It's not affordable to have a four-bedroom house, so you're making it affordable by having two bedrooms.
Serving more families.
We have two units. As a town, we get two out of four bedrooms. We get two units that go to our number versus having one four-bedroom house that We don't, they look at units, they don't look at how many people you serve, so they look at units.
And how many duplexes in town do we have, and what's the zoning process for a duplex versus?
It's a condo, it's not a duplex.
Well, it's a duplex anyways.
Well, it's two units.
It's adjoining units.
It's still a condo unit, so each unit is a single unit.
Right, no, but I think her question, and I don't know, did you know, Laura, for one unit or two units?
I'm sorry, one person at a time.
What is the permitting process for a two-unit versus a one-unit and one lot?
You mean Commonwealth?
Oh, I think you can have two units as part of a special permit through the planning board.
Okay.
Don't hold me to that, but this would be a comprehensive permit that goes through the ZBA. That's a very different process.
Right.
So, yeah, no, I think you were asking about general, older duplexes.
ZBA, Zoning Board of Appeals, I'm sorry, another acronym. So you have two permitting organizations in town. You have the planning board and you have the zoning board of appeals. The planning board is usually used for larger scale development. Or if you are taking a large parcel on a road and you're subdividing that maybe into two, three, four different parcels. And so they have a checklist, they have a process, they issue the type of permit based on the type of development. When you are doing affordable housing, well, let me back up. Then the zoning board of appeals is usually if you are on a non-conforming lot, like I'm sure most of you are, and you maybe want to add on to your house, or you want to add a garage. So you're doing something that's making that non-conforming lot even more non-conforming. You don't have that 25-foot yard setback. So you have to go to the zoning board of appeals to get approval. Once they give you a permit, they give you approval, you have to go down to the registry of deeds, attach that to your deed, so that when you finally sell your house, you're showing that you are legally approved to have the house that you're selling. Make sense? And I know that because I have had to do that personally. So now, when we're talking about affordable housing, all of a sudden the Zoning Board of Appeals does more than just setbacks. Okay, they actually are the permitting organization for affordable units under state law, Mass General Law, Chapter 40B. And they have to go through and evaluate certain criteria. And so that process, you're going to have to find out more from the Zoning Board of Appeals.
But they are public hearings.
Yeah.
They are advertised. In
yep.
that case, you don't just get a courtesy notice of the hearing.
Right.
The abutters and the abutters to the abutters get certified mail, so
yep.
everybody is going to hear it. You have a right to be heard by the zoning board. They will record your comments. There is an appeal process. If someone feels that the zoning board exceeded its authority, it's all spelled out in Mass General Laws.
Right.
We're hearing kind of an informal, this is how it works.
Right.
This is the formal part that's still to come.
Right.
So there's
exactly.
no difference if it's two units or one unit?
In this case, no.
It
no.
would be the same.
And when
they
say
non-conforming,
just I think non-conforming gets kicked around a little bit, and the idea is when something's non-conforming, if it's conforming, it means you can build there without permission. Non-conforming means you can't build there without permission. And essentially, that's what it doesn't mean that it's, you know, it doesn't mean that it's too small to build. Doesn't mean that it just means of the way this is currently set up, it doesn't meet the minimum. There's a by right kind of development, and that is like if you have a nice piece of 2 acres and it's flat and there's and you got all the setbacks and everything, you can just build there. You don't have to ask permission to build there. But if you have to get your regular permits and stuff, but nobody can say no because well, we don't like you, right? But when it's a non-conforming lot, you have to ask permission. That doesn't mean that there's any problem with the land. I mean, in this case, we'd be having challenges and stuff. But the fact just means that if you can't build there by right, you have to ask permission of the town. I don't know what the percentage is. A large percentage of the houses that are built here, and probably your neighbors, are on non-conforming lots,
especially around Lake.
Especially
because they were built as the lake developed. As a destination, talk to me about the history sometime.
I don't think we have time.
No, but my lot at the other end of the lake is barely a third of an acre.
Right.
The house is set on one end of it, and I have some open space beside it. If that were undeveloped and was not grandfathered in, and somebody bought that lot, you couldn't build a house on. I own a second lot that's on the corner that's a third of an acre. I pay $76 a year in taxes on it because it's non-buildable. That's great for me. I just put stuff there. but I would hazard a guess that probably 85% of the houses around Lake Boone. There are non-conforming lots.
Conform, but there were
conforming to the current zoning.
Before zoning, right.
Which is an acre and a half.
I will tell you that probably 85% of the houses in Harvard Acres are not.
Right. Jen?
I think, isn't there, I've heard there's, even though for duplexes, there's even more restriction if it's near wetlands areas or in a wetland area. Is that not so?
I don't know about that. I don't know.
Any regulations regarding wetlands will have to be met if they apply.
The Conservation Commission.
Yeah, they're jurisdictional.
Yeah, it doesn't matter what's being built. They measure distance and impact to wetlands, not what's being built.
Just one other question on the deed that I meant to ask earlier. because these lots were recorded in the late 1800s, some of them, a lot of the lots across the street from the lake had deed access to the lake. And some places it's like a 3-foot wide path through somebody's side yard. Do we know, are there any such deeded
I have
access restrictions?
Somewhere in this pile of papers, there's the deed. And I gotta find it again.
Yeah.
Did I? Oh, you ended up with it.
If it was owned,
I thought there were several copies.
If it was
no,
owned
it was only
by,
one. You did the one guy.
If it was owned by Hanson's, that ran Hanson's Beach, where I used to go play pinball machines when I was a kid, in the Parachot's house, where it is now. Not in your house.
McWalter.
There's no access to that.
So
because it was common ownership at one point.
Right.
So there wouldn't have been a need for that.
Right.
For that.
There's no access.
Okay, that's fine.
Here's one little phrase in here which I don't understand. This conveyance is made together with an easement of a right of way over Pine Point Road as set forth in a deed from Francis F. Hanson's dated October 18th, 1957, and recorded in said deeds, blah, blah, blah. So, I don't know what that is.
There could be.
So there could be.
That's the kind of thing that you find.
Right, that is the kind of thing that you find, and I don't know. So that's one of those things that we have not looked into.
Ask the council to look into that one.
Right, and I think Mike, you had brought up that there's a discrepancy between the description of your lot and the description of this lot. In terms of this lot, it very clearly goes up to both roads, and I think that you had said that your deed that you have a copy of says that it extends, your property extends over the road, and so we have to, I think that's something that we need to address. That's one of the things on our list that we need to sort out. It's clearly on this deed, it says it goes up to the road. This property goes up to Sudbury Road and up to Pine Point. So I think that's something we need to address probably privately, take that offline.
I had heard from some other people that the road is not where it's supposed to be.
Well, that's, that's an entirely true possibility.
I know.
Well, I don't know what world, I don't know what world that we
surveyors.
Live in. I don't know which
surveyors.
World we live in. I don't know the world that the supposed to be world or the real world.
Depends who put the road in, right?
And what the resolution of
this lot.
Pardon?
This lot has not been surveyed.
I was going to look for the surveys. Yeah, we do have some surveys.
It has been, as part of the engineering set, it was surveyed.
Well, the parcel itself, I don't know about that.
But again, with we don't know about the easement. But again, it's not unusual for old deeds. My wife and I had this same issue on some other property that we owned, where there was a discrepancy of 50 feet. And when we, you know, it all got dug into, you know, we had to go back far enough to that there was a common line that was set up. And the problem is some of those old times, the resolution of the surveying methods were not. It's like, you know, there's an ash on the corner to an old stone wall, and they're like, neither of which are here anymore. Yeah. So it's like,
or they move.
Yeah, or they move, or the tree might go away, and then maybe, or the people, so it's going to be hard to resolve. But
so,
the,
Mike,
yeah.
We have control of this lot currently, correct?
Right.
So if we chose, if say there is an easement through somebody's, right through their house, we could redo the deed and eliminate the easement.
Excellent.
So,
that's a potential issue that we could do if there's an easement. There's a dispute about where the land is, there's an easement through your property. Maybe it's something that we can swap through and make sure that and clean it up so that everybody agrees with what it should be, right? So, I think this is something that we need to take offline and, talk with you privately about, because it doesn't really involve the rest of the people here.
Well, Habitat needs to clear.
Well, right, right, Habitat. Well, we do before, I think we even, before we transfer, right? We need to.
Yes, but they initiate.
Right, you're going to initiate the title search and all that kind of stuff. And
so you, when you transfer, what's that process and where is that? You officially, you're in control of it now. When does it get transferred?
It's not transferred yet.
Right.
It hasn't been transferred.
It has not been transferred. So there's a, so
you,
when it, there's a, first there's a purchase and sale agreement that has a number of contingencies. Do you want to talk, you do this all the time. Do you want to talk about it from your perspective?
So there will be a purchase and sale between us. There will probably be a development agreement
as well
that says that we have to develop in a certain amount of time for this to, the deal to continue, and that we have to be able to secure permits for this, right?
So if the, if, follow that, if the Zoning Board of Appeals, for instance, mm-hmm. turns you down, mm-hmm. what happens then?
Then the land's back to
the land. The land is not transferred.
We don't transfer the land.
We just don't close it.
We've done a purchase and sale and a development agreement.
Contingent. Okay.
Yes.
Right. Janet, did you have a question?
I just wanted to bring up a few things that are also very unique about Pine Point Road. And for people who don't live there, it's in the historic district. And I think one thing that it would be good to take into consideration is in the type of housing that's put up there. Certainly, we don't always have any control over it, and there's all different types of houses, but I think if you wanted to do something, I think something like a cottage-style house, you could look directly across the street from this lot, and there's kind of a vernacular cottage there. It's really very, very nice, and it fits in with the neighborhood, and if you downscale this to one cottage, that might be more reasonable. And I mean, I'm not in favor of doing this lot at all, but for the other reasons I said, but at least check into the historic aspect of it. Second thing is there's safety issues with this one lane. It's one lane country road, and there's kind of the code of the West on Pine Point Road. If you're going one way and somebody else is coming the other way, there's the courtesy of pulling over. And I noticed that that has some kind of, it's sort of decayed over the past, you know, X number of years.
No, it's so more like chicken. You know, like
I know it's what's the word I'm seeking for? I think I'm not allowed to say anything about density, or, you know, get the hook out
you
of
can say whatever you like.
For laws and everything. But I think you have to think about that realistically. That this isn't like a regular road, and the problem is frequently these trees fall down, and even several days without. With the tree blockage is a real risk for the health.
So this house is going to be what, about 20 or 30 feet away from Sudbury Road, so they'll be go right on to into their driveway and only drive a very short.
Well, I don't think you can put a rule that that's the only way they're going to drive, and also they're going to
have
traffic.
Put a fence up or whatever.
The primary.
They're going to take the shortest route, though, right?
On my road, I go to my house and I turn in. I usually don't go all the way past it. Sometimes, but
yeah. I think you have to take into consideration the whole neighborhood, which is right there. The
considering if I lived there, I would drive on Sudbury Road and I turn right in. I'd have no reason to go down Pine Point.
Well, I'm trying to explain to you. Do you live on Pine Point Road?
I walked on there many a time for my dog.
What happens, and we've gone through this with people having to redo their septics, when a tree falls down, the whole access for us is blocked.
Right.
So I'm not particularly talking about the homeowner in this sense. I'm talking about the safety of the people on Pine Point Road.
Okay.
And since I'm one of the youngest people on Pine Point Road, I think, you know, we got some issues. A few ambulances might be coming. All right. So I'm just throwing that in there because that's what
well, I think we should make sure that we take, if we've recorded that as a concern. I think that somebody else had mentioned that as well. I think we just have, if there's any impact, I don't think we can afford to do a full traffic study, but I think what we might be able to do is talk to the highway department and ask them for an opinion.
There is other access from the other end. You go over Barton Road and come
Good
back.
Is it a private road?
Yes. All the lakes are, all the streets around Lake.
But it can take 5 to 8 minutes in an emergency or fire or a heart attack.
I think it would be appropriate to ask the highway department if there's anything that we can do to mitigate any concerns that might be coming up and see if there's anything that we can do. I don't know. We can't do a full traffic study. That's not within the, for a couple units, that's not really within the financial ability for us to do. But
I know at least from a planning board permitting perspective, every application has to go by our public safety officials. So the fire chief, the police chief, yeah, they all review everything, so.
Okay, that's good. Well, that's good. That's good to know.
Mike, can you finish our checklist?
Sure.
I don't think we finished. And just clarify, when is the PNS signed in this process? And also, we know that Habitat for Humanity is going, will be at the town meeting because there's a
We did want to get to the CPC article.
CPC article. I think we need to speak to that.
Absolutely. So this is Habitat has applied for CPC money. That's community preservation, sorry, and that's separate. And the only thing I'd like to say about it is that if the project, that money is only, if the project doesn't get permitted, then that money is never used. The question is, there are other groups in town that have the right expertise to determine from a safety, from a septic, from all those other reasons. If all those permits, and after all the input, those permits are given and there's bills incurred for the construction, at that point, Habitat would submit those bills to CPC, and CPC would approve or not the payment of them based on their rules in terms of how the Community Preservation Act statute applies. So if that article were to fail, it would mean that all those funds would have to be raised privately, and it would take longer. It would not necessarily mean that the project doesn't get done. It just means that, but the question would be really for the town, is that if these units are going to be, if we're going to build units here, is this a good deal for the town? Is this a good value for the town to put some of the CPC money, which is restricted for, in this case, those funds can only be used for affordable because they're coming from the restricted funds. Is this a good use of those funds toward the creation of these
units?
What's
the amount of the article?
150.
So 75 per unit, essentially.
I just want to mention that from previous talks that Mike has given, my understanding is that to build a unit new with, just write a check for it, it costs about $325,000 to build a single affordable unit. So in this case, Habitat is offering to build two affordable units for half the cost of one.
But you have to add in after the subsidy that the town is making in terms of the grant of land, but still.
It is a very good number.
But it's still a very good number, right? It's still a very good number. So that's, if you have any, since it's your application, do you have anything you want to,
We did a great job.
Okay, so. But, so the idea is there at that point, this project is not on the town meeting warrant, but the question is, does the town, if this all works and as a town we decide we're going to go forward with this, do we want to participate in the funding of it and to that level? So that's what that question is.
Can you get back to answer the question?
Yes.
When is the PNS signed and do they go to the, does Habitat go to the boards after the PNS is signed?
One of the reasons that we needed control, that we needed to have the deed, is so that we could enter into a PNS agreement. And the PNS is the purchase and sale. Sorry, you're supposed to be catching
that
me
one
on this.
I know.
That well, you know.
I know that.
You're supposed to be. But anyway, so you can't go to the permitting board. You can't apply for certain funding without having control of the land, which means you already entered into an agreement. So we need to enter into this purchase and sale agreement and do a development. Now, because this is a friendly 40B, in this development agreement, we can put certain conditions on the things, that has not been finalized. We have a draft of that, it's not been finalized. But there are certain things about within a certain period of time that we've not gotten the permits, then the town can extract from the, but it's a long period of time because we know the average time of building an affordable unit from conception to building is 7 years in the Commonwealth.
From where we are now, what's the realistic date for having somebody move in? If everything works.
2 years?
I wear rose-colored glasses.
Yes, you are. You're saying you're saying
what do your glasses tell you?
My glasses say by next August we can have the family.
Next, you mean this coming August?
No.
A year from August.
Yeah.
18
months.
But two years would be reasonable.
So the construction period is, how long do you think it's going to be? The construction period, that's pretty much a hard one, right?
Right, yeah, so about 12 months.
So, speaking of which, so there's two separate units being built. Are they gonna be built simultaneously with two families?
Yes.
Okay.
Because it makes sense, economies of scale for the trades, kind of electricians, plumbers, yes.
Mike, just so I'm clear, we're gonna have a talk before PNS is signed over to them or signed or presented to them?
Sure, but, you know, we, I think it's part of that whole process.
Well, the deed part.
The deed part, we have to, we should, we'll have.
Certainly before closing, I'm not sure if during the PNS.
We're gonna have a talk right away because we wanna resolve it.
Yeah.
Yeah, we need clear title for the buyers, okay? And we don't want any questions between your title and our title, and so.
That has to, so the deadline for that is closing, which is a long way off. But just because we're doing, I mean, this is, you know, we wanna address this soon so that we can, you know, we have a check mark of concerns, and that's one of the concerns, and we wanna knock it off the list. So there's, I guess it's good to, where there's, we've captured concerns. We're gonna go to the different boards and get whatever their input is. There will certainly be an official public hearing at the ZBA level. I suspect that, and we invite folks to come, we have a monthly meeting for SMAHT, and if there are concerns that come up, there's the LPC meetings that come up that you can discuss things that were really kind of more of a Habitat meeting. And, I'm sorry, the local project committee.
Well, you did say that earlier.
I know, I forgot.
All right, right, right.
I'm so glad you asked.
You did say it before.
I know.
This is unfortunately, this is the slow.
He's been doing this too long.
I have. But so the local project committee will have, I don't know, monthly meetings? Or is it more frequent than that?
Every 2 weeks.
2 weeks. So for concerns.
Next one's the 18th.
Pardon?
The next one's the 18th.
And where are they held?
At the Randall Library, 7:00 upstairs.
Be there.
Be there.
Yes.
Are there gonna be notices of those in the calendar, in the paper? Good idea.
The first one was, I'm not sure if we got them in the second one.
They're always very cooperative.
We will try to do that.
Sure, all we have to do is ask them.
And Stow and Penn.
May not. Maybe. Downtown, maybe. And also, so we have monthly meetings, and if there's things that are about what SMAHT's role is in this process, that's an appropriate time to bring it up. And, you know, my name and number and my email are on the website, and I'm happy to give them out to folks. I'm not gonna put them out on TV because I don't know who's watching. but go to the website and take a look at how to reach me. I think I've sent some of your email. We'd love to have an email Mike, I sent an email to you, but I didn't have a lot of other people's email addresses. I think that maybe we should do a sign-up sheet and stuff. People want to email if there's information about the project as we go forward. Maybe we can do some sort of Google group or something like that so that people can join in. And we don't have to, you know, we don't have to reach out. It can be something that people opt into. So, I mean, look at what the options there are for, oh, you want to pass, would you? Thank you. Let's pass it. So if you want to leave us your email address about the, you know, about the project or about anything. I want to point out that we have two openings on the Affordable Housing Trust. So
now that you've seen how much fun
that we have.
And we've learned all the jargon.
And now you've learned, you've put all this effort in.
Well, we have help.
Yeah, right, exactly, right.
Well, Laura, I had to have a meeting with Laura and said, Laura, just explain everything. Like, I'm in fourth grade.
I'll explain affordable housing for coffee.
That's right. Actually, you pay for your own.
A couple of questions.
So
yes.
There were conflicting meetings last night, so there's actually a finance committee meeting.
Oh, right.
They're just on the agenda, and Habitat for Humanity, and so.
Will that always be the case? Or finance committees meet?
Finance committees.
Needs an alternate chair. Tuesday.
So we picked the same Tuesday.
Well, but after town meeting, there won't be a lot for them to do.
Okay.
The way, leading up to town, this is the busiest.
For the next 6 weeks or something, they're gonna be.
Just a clarification, the finance committee meeting yesterday was really, when it relates to this, is the discussion of the warrant article with regard to the $150,000. And the finance committee did support that.
Supported the what?
The $150,000.
The $150,000, thank you.
I think it's been a lot more on the agenda last night.
Yes.
Yeah, there was a lot of agenda. So more, another question, you said you had two?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, that was it, okay. So we try, sorry for the confusion, but.
Was it something you set all this gizmo up for, did you not do it?
You had, in case.
Just if people had questions, I think we've covered most of them.
Yeah, I was curious too.
It looks good.
Just in case you forgot where you were.
The date is fading, it's getting so late.
Yeah.
It's almost the next day, right, exactly. Yeah, no, we see, if there are specific things about the site or something like that, if there's specific questions, we had a few pictures that just, it's easier to do pictures than to say, you know that thing over there that's over across from that other thing that's there, so.
And it included the mission and vision of Habitat, if anyone was curious, some past home designs.
Yes, so, well, you know what, well, maybe you can give it to us.
Or you can stay for another hour.
If you know, why don't you give it to us and we'll put it up on the website, the SMAHT website, and then folks want to take a look at it, and folks who couldn't be here, stuff that'll allow them to see those slides as well.
Tell people how to find the SMAHT website.
So it's stow-mat.gov/SMAHT. No, SMAHT Housing Trust. Housing_trust.
You don't know it, how do you spell it?
Maybe you can email it to us.
Yes.
Well, go to the town website, look under departments, and it's Housing Trust. So that's pretty easy. So I can, that's the only way I find it. I don't even.
Google it.
Google it.
Yeah, there are many other SMAHTs.
Nobody else, never mind.
So, if in, I'm, it seems like questions are starting to slow down. I want to make sure that we.
Got a burning question.
Yes, sir.
Can we leave?
Can we leave?
He wants to go.
You can leave whenever you like.
Itching for 15 minutes.
You can leave whenever you like. But so if there's no further questions, then we would entertain a motion to adjourn.
I would second.
Second. Any discussion about the motion adjourn? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. And watch for yourselves on television over the next couple of days. See how you look.